an after. Give me a signal. Hello, I'm Carolyn Bysline, and I'm representing the Central Florida Society for Historic Preservation. My co-worker today is here, Marla Faithful-Simer, as usual, with her camera, to help me interview Nan and Freeman. I didn't notice, but it didn't come along. You didn't want to come.
I didn't notice.
You didn't think it was necessary. All right. I thank you so much, Nan, for coming today and making the effort. And we want to talk a little bit about the history of Longwood and your history of Longwood and how you lived here in the first place and so on. I guess that really is my first question, how it was that your parents came to Longwood and when. Do you have any idea?
My dad was here and my mother came down to visit her her brother who was working on the road department building. He was building, he's the highway department, I forget what they were working. Oh, Dixie Highway, I think. And so she was staying with them, and she met Harold, my dad, who was at that time working at his father's grocery store. And they started dating, and they were riding around one day delivering groceries and in 1928, and he said, how about let's getting married?
Oh.
And so they didn't have a waiting period, so they went to the courthouse. Must have been on a Saturday. They were riding around delivering groceries. I thought she said it was on a Saturday, but anyway, they were delivering groceries. But because I remember that it was Judge Hand that married them, and that was in May of 1928. And so I was born 4 years later in 1932 in a house that was owned by the Riders, and I'm not sure you know where the Rider property is.
Yes.
And then my brother was born in 1934. Then they had bought a home, and it was on the main road in down by the main road in Longwood now. I guess it's called Ronald Reagan Boulevard.
Yeah, 427.
427,
yes.
Right? Yeah. And the house, I don't think the house is there anymore, but he was born there, and we lived there until 1935. Whenever my dad bought this property up here that's now was built in 1914 by the McGadies, and he bought it from a man that was a banker that I can't remember, because it only had two owners.
The banker?
Before. Yeah, the banker in law had the bank up there. And Mr. Walker, wasn't he a banker?
Walker?
I'm not sure. I believe he was a banker. But anyway, he had passed away, and Ms. Walker sold it. So my dad bought the house and part of the property, at that time, I forget how many acres were there, in 1935. I know we moved up there in 1935 because I can vaguely remember having my third birthday party up there.
And I
was really excited.
You can remember your third birthday?
I can't remember all of them. There's been a lot, but I can remember my third birthday party. And we were really excited. We had this house here. My mother was not pleased that my dad bought the house, so she immediately went up and stayed the summer with my, took us up to Havana, where they lived, Havana, Florida, and we spent the summer up there while my dad had the house remodeled, and then she came back, and so
she liked it better then.
She did, and back then there was a man named Jan Furniture in Orlando, who would go around and see people that were had bought a house, and so he came out one day, and because we did not have a lot of furniture during the 30s, and so he brought all this furniture in the house, and my dad said, I didn't order any furniture. He says, if you don't want any of it, he said, then you don't have to keep it.
Oh my goodness!
So we brought all this in, all this furniture. We ended up keeping most of it, but that was he had a huge chair on. It was on Orange Avenue, and he had a huge chair advertising his place. It was in the postcards and everything. This great big chair advertising.
I remember that.
Yeah. So anyway, that's how our house got furnished. And my dad ended up keeping most of it. Very few pieces did he let go.
And so that was probably would be antiques. So same thing. If there was any left.
Yeah.
Well, was that name Yon, did you say?
Yon, I believe. It was Yon's Furniture.
I seem to remember that name.
Seemed like it was Y-O-N. I could be mistaken. I wasn't Yon. I'm pretty sure.
I'm pretty sure I remember that picture. Well, that is very interesting, and I was wondering if you were a Longwood native.
Oh, yes.
No, I thought you. I thought that was right. Now, you see, I'm trying to get your relationship with Liv. You were related to Liv Boffel, I know, and her maiden name was Jackson.
Right.
That's one reason I brought this picture. Yeah. We've talked with Liv and Jean, and Liv said she moved here as an infant with her parents from Maitland. Mm-hmm. She's just a few months old.
She was six
so
months old.
So I wanted to get that straight. Now, are you her aunt or aunt, or is she
yours? She's my aunt. She was my father's only sister.
Okay.
So there were four boys and one girl. Liv was the youngest of all the children, and so she was
I had a little trouble getting that straight.
Yeah, because Liv was we always joke about that. She's 7 years older than I am.
Yeah. Well, that's interesting too, because I know then that you know a lot about Longwood that you can tell us. I wanted to find out if you grew up here, and then did you attend school in Longwood? It was Lyman.
Right. Lyman then was, there wasn't a kindergarten course, and then was 1 through 12. And I went all the way through school, and I think there were not very many kids that came from all over. That was the only elementary school here in the area. I came from Bear Lake, Almont, all over. Some of us started and graduated together, like the Hounds. There were only 12 in my graduating class.
Is that right? I think some of the others have told me that they have very small graduation.
And we occasionally get together. I'm still, some of them, many of them have passed away, but
You look so young, you look to me, I'm not placing you where you say you were. I mean, I find that difficult. Now, the house that you lived in, that you were talking about, which your father had renovated, is that the one that's now occupied by the legal?
That's right. Yeah. I lived in that house from 1935 until 1996, and it was the most difficult decision ever to have to leave there. I did grieve for it, and I still have not gone through the house. I am sometimes going to go through the house, because when you live in a place that long, and
yes.
We, of course, grew up there. I was married at that house. I brought the.
You were married there?
No? Married in the home. I have pictures of our wedding there in the home.
Doesn't it have a hallway down the center?
There's just a little bit. I came out of my bedroom and there, and Reverend Jackson, who was the minister then of First Baptist Church, married us. Glenn Payne was there, Glenn and Martha, and Lib and Ms. Aldo Milwee, right?
Yeah, the Milwees,
they were all there, and I have pictures. And there's Tom Milwee, he and Lynn were little, and they were sitting in a chair looking in awe at this bride that came out. And my mother had passed away earlier. That's why we had a small wedding at home. My mother passed away earlier that year. And I was married there. Then we moved to Orlando for a year.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
And my dad was not doing really well by himself, and so we were in between renting places, and he said, "Well, why don't you come stay with me for just a while till you find a place?" Because we were both working in Orlando, and so okay. So we came out to stay, and that was in 1950. We were married in 52. That was the end of 1953. And we ended up staying until 1996. We had found a place, and he said, "You know, I wish you wouldn't leave." He says, "I am so lonesome." He said, "I wish you wouldn't move."
Yeah.
So we didn't, and it worked out real well. He was the only boy that Bud was the only boy my dad ever approved of at all. There was always something wrong, and he really got along real well with him. So they got Bud is really easy to get along with as well.
Well, now isn't that called a cracker house?
It is a cracker house.
That's part of the Magnolia development. And I think Bonnie Bandura was in there for a while, wasn't she? Bonnie, wasn't that where Bonnie Bandura had an office there at least one time? I think that's legal.
I remember Mother talking about it because there was a hallway all the way through when you went in, just like the old Cracker House. There was a hallway all the way through the house.
I would think I was there.
All the way through the house. And so my dad had that cut off there, and part of the hallway became a bathroom. So that ended there. And then that went up the back porch. Yes, it was a Cracker House. And then and it was really dark in there, and so he had a skylight put in.
Well, I recall, and maybe Jean remembers it, that Bonnie Mangiro was the name of the lady that was over there for a while, I thought.
The building here across the street belongs to Bonnie.
Okay, is that where she is now?
She's
not there anymore? No.
But she still owns the building.
Okay, so there's a little confusion there about who owns it or who's there now. So it's now that legal age.
Yeah, we were there were only three owners until we sold it. There were only three owners there. Gradually my dad added to the property so that we owned all the way back. There would be 44 acres here.
44 acres, mm-hmm. man? Mm-hmm. See, that's how we used to live.
And the kids, they had dirt bikes, and that was a great place for them to grow up. And the dogs had big dogs. The dogs could run and...
You had a nice, really wonderful childhood.
I did. I think it was a great time to grow up.
Any memories you'd like to share with us about your childhood? Yeah.
Oh, I remember. Of course, there were never any cars going down, or rarely, and that the street here, and you could skate down the street. We'd skate down skate down the sidewalk, and skate down the middle of the street, and go into Doc McReynolds' store up there, his drugstore, and ask for a glass of water. I know he used to get so aggravated, and we'd go. Doc McReynolds, by the way, had a dog named Gus, and he never married. He was brother to Doc McReynolds in Sanford. McReynolds in Sanford had a drugstore. Dr. McReynolds here, I don't think he was a pharmacist. He just had a Sunday store. Had a dog named Gus, and Gus would sit in that little car right beside him, and they'd go all over. Doc McReynolds lived in the back of the store. I remember there was a lady named Ms. Ronaldo that over close behind some of those side streets behind the church, where the First Baptist Church used to be. We used to go over in the afternoon. She let us climb up there, she never married. She had a little black Scotty. And we would climb up in the tree and eat mulberries.
Mulberry trees were popular then. A lot of people had mulberry trees. Mm-hmm. We did too. My sons did.
Yeah. And there were no girls here, and so I grew up which was fine with me because I had a brother, and the boys were all there, and I learned to play boy games. I climbed trees and I could shoot marble better than any, maybe a couple of other. And I remember that we went any place, we never locked the door. I don't care where we went. I mean, we would be gone on vacation, which once in a while. But I remember when we were six. My dad took us to North Carolina. We didn't lock the door, and my mother said, "Well, you know, Miss Gray might need to come in and borrow some sugar." So I mean, we never locked the doors.
We didn't worry about locking doors.
We didn't have any. I think the only key we had was a skeleton key. Yeah. And of course, the skeleton key would fit everything.
Yeah. Did Bud live near here now, or how did you meet Bud?
He lived in Lake Mary. He was born in Alabama.
They moved
to Lake Mary. He was in grade school, and they moved to Lake Mary. And then he joined the Navy.
Yeah, I was going to say military.
Then when he came back, one summer I was working at San Lando Springs, and he came out, and... he asked to take me home, and I saw what kind of car he was driving. He had a brand new Mercury convertible.
Oh my goodness!
So I was very much attracted. We didn't really date very long, and like I said, my dad really liked him the first time he met him. So that worked out right. In Longwood, then you knew everyone's pets. I remember Clyde Walker used to live right behind here.
Oh, yes.
Clyde Walker, by the way, lives not too far from me at the beach now.
Well, is that right? I didn't know that.
He's affiliated with the Methodist Church over there. He's one of the ministers. He lived right over there. And I remember his dog Pete got killed, and we all cried because Pete died. You just knew everybody's.
Yeah.
It was a great time to grow up. It really was.
We need to have another old timers get together and get back with some people. You know, Delton Helms was the one that kind of ran the show before. I think he was really good to help with that. And I don't know how he's doing, but I'd like to try to get back with him and maybe get some of us together again.
That'd be great. Now, Helen, his wife, was my maid of honor.
I didn't realize that. But you had a small wedding. But you had a great childhood, it sounds like.
I did.
First through 12th grade at Lyman, that's where I was in. And they came from all around. We had just so few schools, high schools, or schools in the area, as you mentioned. So almost everybody went to Lyman. And your boys ended up going to Lyman, too.
To Lyman, right.
Yeah, later. And then our children with us, with Fred and I.
My mother taught at Lyman, by the way, whenever she was a teacher also. So she taught at Lyman, She was teaching when she was teaching when my mother and daddy got married.
Did she teach with Rosebuds North or any of those?
I have a picture of Rosebud and Lucille Wells. I don't believe
Mr. Wells.
Ms. Wells also taught.
Okay.
And I have a picture of a mother when she was teaching, and that would have been. But back then, it was frowned upon for a married woman to teach school, and so they kept it a secret until until May of. I guess school was out that year. Must have been out later than that because they got married in May, so then later in the year. But then I don't remember that she taught after then. Maybe they didn't rehire, but then she did go back to substituting during the war because teachers were in shortage. But
I'd like to see some. If you have any yearbooks or some of that, those.
I do. I do have a lot of yearbooks, and I'd be glad to share them.
Yeah. Sometimes, as I said, it would be good to get together and just.
I really like that, to get together with at least one more time.
I'm going to throw out some names that I recall. I mentioned the McGays. Do you remember anything about the McGays?
I do not. He got interested in doing Florida.
This is your son now.
My son. When he was a junior, I believe it was a junior in high school, they were given assignments to write on some, out of whatever, and he got interested in Longwood history.
I have a copy of that here now. I brought it today.
Okay.
And also, my son Walter did the same thing to Hal later.
Uh-huh.
But his isn't as long or as thorough as Hal's was. Hal really researched well and did a lot of thorough checking into the history of Longwood, and I thought he was to be commended. And I even have the scrapbooks, that I've been doing for the Historic Society with his write-ups in the newspaper, clippings of from old things he found at the hotel.
Right.
Pictures like that and the write-ups about him.
Yeah, he has his home completely furnished.
I would love to do an interview with him sometime.
I'm sure he'd be glad to. Hal also did interviews with a lot of people. Jones, remember Mr. Jones, the black man?
African American, yes.
And I'm sure he still has it. He did this tape. You can barely hear Mr. Jones talking about, that was Alvin and, what was the other one's name? Amos and Andy Jones' dad. Amos used to come up and let me ride his horse. So, Hal did an interview with him, and he remembered the trees in the 90s when he said you could walk and hear the trees, orange trees cracking, and he has that interview with Mr. Jones.
Oh, yes, about the priest.
It was not video, but it was a tape.
What did you say about Amos and Andy? That's what they were called.
That was their names. Amos and Andy. And I don't know if Amos is living. Wait a minute. Amos is not living. Andy, and I ended up teaching, Amos's two children when I was teaching in Hamilton, I taught, he had two children named Alvin, and I don't remember the girl's name, but they were Amos and Andy.
Oh my goodness.
And Miss Jones used to work in the neighborhood. She was a housekeeper in the neighborhood.
Now this Amos Jones had a job not so terribly long ago with the county.
Yeah, he passed away.
Yeah.
He did pass away. Yeah, he had a good job at the county. But I don't know where Andy is. I don't know.
Now who is this minister who's presently going to, we're planning to interview sometime. He was also black, African American, and Longwood. I'm not sure of his name, but my brother-in-law will be interviewing him, and Marla probably. Is it Jones? Do you remember the name by any chance, Paula?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, that's something that John is going to do as soon as check with him, and he is going to interview him. But he has met him before. For some reason, they ran into each other, or for some reason, he knew him, or getting to know him. So we will be interviewing him. I don't know all those families or really how that works with those families anymore. Whoever's left from the Jones.
No.
I just remember that old
house
on
434
that stood for so long
when
they finally took it down.
Well, you know, when Mrs. Jones was 85 years old, she used to do some housework for them and I.
Yes. That's right.
I heard that
she did some housework,
yeah.
And she worked for here for you and Liv. Yeah. Did you remember the Fleeces? That's another black lady.
Yes.
Right. So
she passed away just fairly recently.
Yes.
Out by the Winn-Dixie.
Yeah.
So I don't know what's going to happen to her property out there. She's been living there for all those years. And so we still have a few blacks in the area. But I was going to jump back to the store if I could, if I had this picture I wanted to show you.
One thing I do remember that was interesting back then, you know, San Leandro Springs, that was the place everybody went because that was the only place in the summer to go.
I know that. I wanted to mention that too. You mentioned it. I wanted to ask you more about that too because you said you worked there.
I did work there when I was a teenager. One summer, I was 19 then, I guess. But when we were kids, we would go out, and it was just a one-lane road, and if you met a car, which you didn't often, and then you had to get off the road. I mean, you divided the road, so you'd go out there and you'd swim. For a while, you could get in for 10 cents, but my grandmother Jackson worked out there some summers, and then I got in free. So,
And
so we used to go out there and spend the day. Mother would take you out there. When I was little, and Betty Ann Wells, who recently passed away, by the way, she would. She was older, and so Mother would have her go out there with me, and so she would take me to babysit me. That I wasn't taught I didn't need a babysitter, but it did. So then you would ride home on the fenders. Well, you used to put your towel on the fenders and ride home on the fenders because you were wet and you couldn't get in the car.
Yeah, you were wet. That's right.
How about that? Okay, this
picture.
That's
your picture of the store.
Yeah, Granddaddy Jackson's in the...
Now, tell me again, the Jackson name, was that your not your maiden name?
That was my maiden name.
It was your maiden name.
That was my grandfather. That was my dad's father.
Okay.
Okay, and I don't know the other men.
I do, but I can't think of
names are up at the top there.
Douglas, Jackson, Paul Jackson,
So did he own that store?
Yes, he did.
Yes.
Okay. He did.
And was it mostly cigars? It looked like they got the cigar.
He had a grocery store. Well,
that store there is the other guy, one of those other guys in the picture. That's his store. That wasn't your
grandpa. Didn't Granddaddy own the store?
Oh,
I thought he did.
That wasn't your granddaddy's store.
Oh.
I thought it was his store.
No.
I'm not sure. Why I have that picture of where it came from. Exactly.
Hal had a picture like this.
We all have one.
Well, I know that you said you have one, and Hal has one too, okay.
I thought it was because whenever we were growing up, there were three grocery stores, Mr. Hartley and Mr. North.
North.
And
wasn't he a butcher?
And
I think he was a butcher.
Yeah, Mr. North and Mr. Hartley. Who was, I can't remember the third one, now I surely would, because that was where Mother, there was a third one, I can't remember that now, but I remember one time my mother got angry with Mr. Hartley because she went in and she said, and of course, Mr. Hartley's wife taught at school. She was my second grade teacher. She was real sweet. But anyway, but Mr. Hartley, she said, Mr. Hartley, I would like to have some stew meat cut up, and I would like to not have any bones in it. And he said, Margaret, I would like to find a cow that didn't have a bone.
That would be her, too. That was a good retort. Good answer, wasn't it?
Yeah. Oh, well, I was funny. Trying to think of the woman. She owned the house, the second house over here, the old house, for a while.
Ms. Hunt.
Yeah.
Ms. Hunt. Oh, she owned that for everybody.
Yeah, Bobby Joe Hunt. That's right. Another name. Yeah. She lived here in Longwood for a lot of years.
Was she
a native of Longwood? She wasn't a native of Longwood.
No, she's been there a long time.
But she was here
Mr.
a long
Hank,
time.
The founder of Longwood, used to live over there.
Yes. Near her,
yep. In the house.
That
was his house.
That was his house. That's right.
That was the first house in Rome.
Okay. The Hick house, yes, I know. Yeah.
And the Hunts also bought the Sullivan. That was the Sullivan. Well, at first it was the Hitzmanger house, and then the Sullivans bought it. And when the Sullivans passed away, the Hunts bought it. So they kept both houses, but they were able to keep their homestead exemption in both houses because they'd live in one house 6 months and then move over here 6 months.
Oh, my goodness.
And I remember, and Mr. Hunt fell down one time moving his mattress back and forth.
Oh, the mattress. She moved the mattress back and forth.
But they lived in one house 6 months. And they had a lot of money. It wasn't the money because he owned a lot of rental property in the black section in Apopka. We always worried, kind of worried about Mr. Hunt, that you would think they didn't have any money. His glasses were all taped together, and he could hardly see out. That's why I tell Bud now. I said, your glasses look like Mr. Hunt's. You can't even see out of them. You need to clean them. So we could. But anyway, he would go over every Saturday night and collect the rent. Everybody knew that. One Saturday night, he got beaten up pretty bad and robbed, he never did that again after that. I forget how it was collected.
Well, now you know, she was talking about it, the way he dressed. He had, his shoes were wired together. He wired his soles onto his shoes because his shoes were so old.
So bad he would not give them up, but he put wire on them.
He put wire on them.
Oh, my soul, I never heard of anybody doing that.
Yeah, he was
mercy.
Yeah, he was.
But he had a ton of money.
Yeah, well, we had a problem, years and years later. With the hotel, when Grace Bradford had the hotel, and finding the original settee, as I call it, which was a round couch-like affair. You know.
I know that one.
What's the name
of
that? That's the name.
The Hallows.
Yes, I just say settee. But it somehow had disappeared, and I said to Grace, last time it was there in that hotel, and you should have it here because that's part of the authenticity. Uh-huh. And she said, try to find it, and Bobby Joe had it stored.
Oh, she
and
did.
We couldn't seem to get it back from Bobby Joe because she wanted to keep that. So we had a little problem there.
Yeah, LT, he had they had the one son. Well, they had a daughter and a son. The daughter died of diabetes when she was in her teens, and I never knew her. But LT, of course, he spent the money that his mom and daddy saved.
Well, I'd like to get to go on a little more about your sons. We mentioned Al and talk about him a little, and you have another son, Brad. Don't want to leave him out. We'll talk about him as a doctor.
He's a doctor.
And married.
He's married. He also married a doctor, and they live in St. Louis. And he's we're quite proud of both of them.
Well, I know you're proud of both of them.
But
sure.
he is a full professor at the university there. He teaches medicine as well as does research and has his practice, and he is a general surgeon specializing in trauma, so he gets all of the really bad cases.
Oh dear.
And they do have two children, one seven and all one almost
they
six.
They do, that's nice.
And then Hal is...
Now, tell me, how many children does Hal have?
Hal has two.
Two?
So we have two sets of grandchildren. Hal has two. Hal got married very young, and Brad waited until he was 40 to get married. So that's why I have two sets. But Hal married, he's 24, and he is a... works with Lockheed Martin. He got his master's, and he's done very well there. He's been there over 25 years. He has two children. One is just, the girl is just getting, they both graduated, both children graduated from UCF, and Jessica's working on her master's, and Ryan is working on his, and he has an excellent job. Right now he's in a training program for corporate at Lockheed Martin in Dallas, Texas.
Well, like you've got some grandchildren to be proud of, too, then.
Yeah, I do. Yes,
that's great. Yeah. I like hearing about Al because I know him a little, and, you know, I've met Dot with him before, and I kind of wish I'd
let it ring because it'll ring five times, and I won't get there.
Oh, okay. Thanks. So when I want to know, they both went to Lyman.
And
you tell me a little bit about how when they graduated, what they've become, what they're doing now, and I'm sure you're proud of both of them. I just wanted to say, if there are any other memories or any other stories that you could tell us about your childhood or after you grew up. I was confused a little bit about when you say you taught school. Now you mentioned
did,
that
I did.
You were
went after I after
later.
After the boys were born. I had had 2 years of college before I got married, and then I worked for McKesson and Robbins after we were married, and whenever we had the two children, I stayed home with them until Brad was in kindergarten, and then I said, you know, I don't really like this staying home with the kids in school.
I'm the same way.
So I went back and got my degree at the university, at UCF. And my bachelor's, my BA, and then I went to work in Sanford at Sanford Grammar, and then it merged later with Hamilton Elementary.
Oh,
so I taught there from I taught school in Sanford from 1972 till 1984. No, from 1972 to 1995, and I retired.
Did you ever have to have double sessions like I did 1 year?
No. What made me help me decide to retire? We went on year-round school, and by about 94, I think they decided to go on year-round school, and it was absolutely horrible.
Yeah,
it was terrible.
You didn't have that summer off.
Because we'd come back. They'd come back, and it was just like starting school all over again. And they're off for 3 weeks. It was just like
I had a problem with the dog people. You know, I feel that. To some of the people that interviewed before, so I won't get into it, but they would come like in December and then be here with the dog track until May maybe or earlier and leave, and then it was trying to catch them up with the other children, you know.
It was terrible. Yeah, you could
have. Because one year we had double sessions.
Oh, that would be awful.
What made me think of that was the buses had to go one area in the morning and then the other area in the afternoon. They didn't go both areas those times. So I had all African Americans, all blacks, in the afternoon, and they were sleepy and tired, wanted naps, and it was hard.
You taught kindergarten.
And so, what grades did you teach?
I always taught fifth grade. Fourth grade. I always taught fifth grade, and then when we got the princess, another thing that helped me to decide to retire because I was 62 then, and I was going to teach till I was 65, but. Then she decided that it would be a good idea for all the teachers that were in kindergarten to go to fifth grade, and all the teachers who were fifth grade to go to kindergarten, and it was a nightmare for everybody. I thought this would be horrible, and the kindergarten teachers didn't like it any better than the fifth grade teachers. So the ones that didn't retire, just about everybody that could transfer.
Well, some of these principals, I don't know if somebody tells them they have to do that or not, but they decide they're going to do that.
But you've taught us.
And they reshuffle completely.
Yeah, I mean, we have all these things for fifth graders, and
a power trip just because they can make you do it, but they do it.
Well, you know, you can teach. I didn't have early childhood on my, so you can't teach. You can't teach. Out of field, I don't think too long. I think you probably. Yeah. Well, I don't think I'm going to last a year.
Early childhood.
1 year, I think.
So, but anyway, that principal is no longer with. Thank heavens.
I could teach through sixth grade. I had that on my.
Yeah, I could too.
I had substitute money.
Yeah.
But I preferred the kindergarten. That was my major.
Yeah, I think it takes a special person.
Do you come to visit Longwood very often now that you've been to Webster?
I do. At first, I came over about 3 or 4 times a week just to come by. And for a long time, I would go right down there. Now I've got to where I can come by the house and I look over there. But I still have. One day I'm going to go up there.
To go over there and just say,
I am going to go
through.
In and ask if I can go through there.
Do that.
But I did grieve for the house. You can't believe you can grieve for something that's inanimate, but. You do.
Well, you live out there. Yeah,
everything. I had some really happy memories there.
Yeah. You mentioned the Helmses and the Binslingers. I mentioned McGee's, and we thought of the others, some of the others, Rosebud North and some of the others who were here earlier on.
Mrs. Tupper was my first grade teacher.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and are there any others that you could think of that we need to think about, old timers that we recall?
Ms. Willis was a third grade teacher.
Willis. Right.
I had Ms. Jackson for my fourth grade teacher, and Ms. Arnett became Mrs. Hilliard. She taught me in the fifth grade, and by the time I was in the sixth grade, she was Miss Hilliard.
I think she taught everybody in Longwood.
I think she did too. Yeah.
She lived to be.
And then the Four Acres.
Quite old. I can remember. 90 something.
Yeah, I think so.
And a few other older ones are not much longer around right now. But we have
Mr. Laney was a principal then.
Laney?
E.J. Laney.
Now, that name I'm not familiar with.
Yeah, he was principal when I was in high school.
Okay.
And, he was principal. Mr. Isbell was principal there. I remember Mr. Skews taught there. He was teaching there when I was about first grade. He was teaching chemistry, I believe.
Ms. Hartley.
She was a really good, she was, I remember, back then you didn't dare misbehave in school because when you got home,
you would get it.
I know, I know that Dorothy Foraker, the Forakers, Foraker told Mrs. Hilliard, Nan is chewing gum. So she put it on my card, my report card, and I was grounded. Mother didn't let me go skating because then the big thing was to go skating.
Goodness.
Because she chewed gum. And I feel like for a long time I didn't like Dorothy. I said, you're a taskmaster.
She ratted on me. We did an interview with Dottie.
Did you?
And she had so much to tell us that we ended up having to come back a second time. And as I mentioned earlier, Marla and I do that way with you. I didn't know how much you could recall today.
We email back and forth. Dottie and I do right now. I think they're trying to get together a history of Longwood Elementary. And she emailed me what I remembered there, and there were some people that I knew that taught there that she was not aware of. And so
I didn't know that she was doing that. I'm interested to know.
Well, let me say that she's not. They're starting, and they're supposed to have an organizational meeting the 29th of this month.
I like to know about that.
Give her a call.
I will, because I'm, with having had children myself in Longwood Elementary.
Yeah, sure. Because she was trying to think. I asked her if she contacted Elda, and she said she hadn't, but that she would. Elda Nichols.
Elda's getting up there not really well.
I know. I've talked with her the last several times. She is still living alone, isn't she?
I think she's at home, but someone's there with her.
Oh, good.
And he has moved to a
nursing
home.
He some time ago.
It's either dementia or Alzheimer's. I'm not sure which.
Yeah. But she said he was very happy there. She was driving over to visit him the last I talked with her. Now, she may not be doing that now. Now, she may not be doing that now because I called her on her birthday, which was in February. I have talked with her since then.
I took all those scrapbooks up there that I used to work on to the Bradley McIntyre house, and I put them in up there because that's our headquarters for our historic society, and I thought that they should be up there instead of in my home. But now I miss them because I'm used to having them available so I can go back and check on something or find a clipping about somebody. And I do have a lot of clippings that I mentioned earlier about Hal and some of his finds and interesting notes about him and so on. So
we took a picture, a video of that. Well, it was on an 8mm when they were moving that down the road. But I don't know whatever happened to that.
We have pictures.
Do you?
You're the ones? Well, somebody knew took pictures. We have them.
Well, maybe Hal turned those over because we did take pictures.
Yeah.
And I thought, well, why would they move that old house here?
I know a lot of people thought that, but we went back and did
it. That and the inside-outside house.
All of us were in debt for a lot of several
years. Beautiful.
But we didn't get the inside-outside house as well with the deal, so it turned out to be nice.
Yes. Longwood's looking beautiful, doesn't it? Yeah.
And I don't know if you're aware of it, when we dismantled the Women's Club, you were a member at that time. I don't know if
we bought some things from there.
Situation there. We had to do something because we were dwindling down to like 6-8 members maybe. And so we gave the the Civic League building to the Historic Society at my suggestion. And that's how it was got renovated. Because we had recently had some renovations done on the building, but it was still in pretty bad shape. So they're spending, they have spent a lot of money on that building, but they're now trying to get back by having weddings and so on.
Oh, yeah.
Going on.
Grace, the property that the inside outhouse sits on belonged to Grace French originally.
Oh, did it really? Yeah. Grace French, really? I can't remember that. I knew that.
Yeah.
The Frenches were prominent. That's another
Frenches,
family.
Yeah.
That we forgot to mention. Bobby was around until fairly recently. Did he die?
Yes, he's been dead for
about a year ago.
Oh, it's been a little while.
Yeah, longer than that again. Yeah. Overstreet.
And we mentioned
Ellen and Betty.
Yeah. And of course there were the Clausers, which were my husband's great grandparents, and the Niemeyers.
No, what was Overstreet's husband's name?
Ben.
Munger.
Mungers are from Sanford.
Mungers, Ellen married a Munger.
Yeah, Ellen Overstreet married.
They lived in the house behind us.
See, I know that because Mrs. Florence Munger married my husband's father.
Oh.
Remember after he was
widowed? I think that was a different family.
Munger.
Now, monkeys live right across the street here.
They lived behind us in that big two-story house when it was standing there. Remember, they lived behind there for quite a while, behind us in that big two-story house that the DeRoses moved into before they moved up there. They lived over there. They lived behind us.
Well, now, Monk lived right over here.
At some time, he probably did. I don't know if they owned there or rented whenever they had there.
Remember the Scots?
Sure.
Yeah, and then now they don't have a garage there anymore. They just...
Did they tear it down?
Tore it down.
Now, what was your friend's name that lived over here?
DeRosa?
No, the guy that you didn't get along with.
Oh, Jack Yarnell?
We didn't mention the
Yarnells, that's right. That's another name that I've
And
heard
I think she's dead now.
Okay. I moved here, I came in 50, I think, 49 or 50. We were married in 49, and we lived a year there in Lincoln until I finished college. And then we moved to Longwood, so it's must have been 50. We had a baby boy, and Walter was just about a year. Anyway, getting off the track of that, but I'm just trying to remember some of the names that I knew when I came here, because immediately I was persuaded, shall we say, to join the women's club. There was no question about it that I had to join the women's club.
That was
Mrs. Beislein was a charter member.
Mrs.
Niemeyer, they were both charter members back, so.
But the Grays were prominent.
Gray.
Ben and Johnny Gray.
Johnny Gray.
And what was the son's name?
And the Brights lived across the street. Oh, there was, I can't think of Mary Catherine Gray.
Catherine, that sounds right.
And their son was kind of a...
And there were the Grants.
Kind of
the Grants?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Any other families you can think of? I've got Gene talking. He's not really on camera. So if you want to put him on camera for a minute, but he's talking too and helping us with these names. Think of anybody else? We just like to think of all.
Of course, we talked about the Hems.
Yeah.
And remember, there was Madden's Corner up there.
Oh, that's right. Madden's Corner was where the the bank was there, and I found a little bank book that was my husband's, where he had a little bit of an account in the bank.
Bank was on the corner.
On the corner. Wasn't that
Madden's? Right up here.
Madden's was on the corner.
Madden's Corner. No, Madden's Corners was there by the railroad, and the bank was in on the corner up here.
And they had the vault in the back, which they used for a dressing room when moons were in there. When the moons came.
The moons, that was where the Walkers, that was where he had his bank.
He had
a bank. That's who my dad bought that from his widow. There was money missing, and the story goes that money is buried on our property someplace. And we used to have a black man named Saul Grant that worked for us for years and years and years. He used to live on the property, but then he moved down behind Scott's garage. He just swore that he knew where that money was. It was underneath the cement slab there where we had an outdoor shower. And I thought, we should really break that open. but whether there was ever any money buried or not, because the money was, some money was missing.
I've never heard that story before.
I never heard that either.
That's interesting.
And there was a well down in the middle of the property. There was also, down in the middle. So, because there used, formerly, house said there was a house down there, because there was an old well down in the middle of this property on the left hand side.
Oh, okay.
Threw oranges down there and hit her hip bottom. It was neat.
Now, I was trying to think of a woman. There was a woman lived down there that Lib used to go to when that house was down there.
Oh, I know who you mean. Yeah, I know who you mean.
I can't think of her name.
The Bridges. Mr. Bridge was the mayor of Longwood.
Yes.
And then his wife married George Reams. She was much older than he was, and then he inherited that was a property out on. Yeah. Adjacent to ours.
Yeah, and for some reason I think of John. They lived out there on the road to Lake Mary.
Farina?
Yes, Farina.
Farina, yes.
Yeah, I forgot to mention the Farina.
Yeah, Helen was a Farina.
Yeah.
I just keep coming up with names as we talk, you know, that come to me as we talk. So that's why I asked if you could throw out any names or I could that would ring a bell, because I'm not a native and have always lived here, but I've been here a lot of years.
You've been here since 1950. You've been here. Yeah, before.
So I can go back quite far with it, and I try to keep up with it, having worked with the scrapbooks like I did for so many years. But anyway, it's been very interesting talking with you and Jean and Cliff, and we appreciate your coming today so much, Taylor.
Sure, sure. If I think of anything else, I'll call you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I appreciate that.
And Hal will be more than glad. Because he's a source of information. I'll say, how did you know so-and-so? He said, Mom, sure. You know, and he really
has a good background. In
he does.
Longwood.
He does. And he also got into Sanford history, but mostly Longwood. He's really interested in Longwood.
I'm pretty sure I brought that magazine or newspaper article. I'll look for it, that story about him. And also his write-up, if you want to look at it before you go today. Is there anything else you could think of that we might talk about while you're here and want to catch up on? Any other thoughts?
I know at the Longwood Civic Center, a woman's club, where we had kind of a team club that was nothing for kids to do, then you just kind of hung out. I mean, it was okay to hang out because nobody bothered you, back then. And so we started a teen center. There was a piano in there, and something on Friday nights, we had a little teen center there for a while.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, I guess I was 14, 15, so that would have been
in
the 40s.
Mm-hmm. You know, I would have thought maybe Dottie would have mentioned that when we did her interview. She didn't think that. I don't think she mentioned anything about teen group.
Dottie is young. No, Dottie's 3 years
she's
younger.
She's only younger?
Yeah, she's younger.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it didn't last very long. There weren't very many kids here then. There really weren't. And as I said, very few.
Well, I remember Fred had fond memories of San Lando.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody went to
it was
the
ashamed
end,
of
at the end
of
the year. Everybody went there like for special occasions, you know. And then when we
had a dance floor out there.
And we got a membership when I came in, and I would take the children out there, you know, almost.
It was a nice place. They had cabins out there. I always said, Mother, why can't we rent a cabin out there? She says, why wouldn't we rent a cabin at Longwood to vacation? I thought it'd be the neatest thing to be able to. She said, you go there almost every day anyway.
Yeah.
So, now there was an Italian guy that ran San Lando Springs.
Oh, really? I don't know that.
I know it because Liv and I worked out there.
We worked out there on weekends. Oh,
so
I think I did know that you worked out there.
Yeah.
And I forgot that.
I just can't think of that.
I just hated it like heck.
I did too.
When they changed it, got rid of it, and then started building houses in there.
But there were two more springs, you know, Shepherd Springs.
Yes.
And the other one.
Palm Springs.
And we'd go there sometimes because you could go for free.
Yeah. There are a lot of fresh water springs, regular natural springs around this area. And people aren't aware of that we had those. Well, I think it's been very nice today, Nan.
Well,
talking with you.
I've really enjoyed it.
And I thank you so much for coming.
You're very welcome.
You're not going to run out.